Hi, my name is Jack Rackham, and today I'm going to give you a brief overview of Asian history using one of the Foldout charts from Matt's Timeline of World History book. We've already done a video about the main chart, which is available on its own as a poster or as part of the book. However, the book version also includes four smaller fold-out charts covering four different regions of the world. We'll be doing videos on all four of these regions, and today we're going to start with Asia. Okay, so first of all, I should mention that if you want a copy of the book, you can check out the various links in the description and pinned comment. Note that we don't sell the book on our regular website, usefulcharts.com. There, we only sell the poster versions. For the book, you have to use a site like Amazon, or even better, just go to your local independent bookstore and ask for it there. When you open the book, you'll find that there are four sections with fold-out charts. Today, we're going to look at the fold-out chart for Asia-Pacific. This chart covers Central Asia, North and South India, Southeast Asia, China, Korea, Japan, and Oceania. The westernmost parts of Asia are included on the Africa and Middle East chart, which we'll be covering in a separate video. The next thing to note is that all of the fold-out charts begin at 800 BCE. Obviously, there is a lot of history that occurred before this point, but for that, you have to refer to the main chart. These more detailed regional charts were chosen to start at 800 BCE because that's around the time when people and events start to become more historically verifiable. Most of the events prior to this point lie within the Bronze Age, where we have to rely more heavily on archaeology rather than on written records. Let's start with China. For around 350 years, northern China, between the Yellow and Yangtze River, had been united under the rule of the Zhou dynasty. But around 800 BCE, the power of the Zhou king was greatly weakened, and China entered a period of disunity called the Spring and Autumn Period. The Zhou king still reigned during this period, but his capital was now in the east, and he had been reduced to a mere figurehead. This is why this period of the Zhou dynasty is called the Eastern Zhou, in contrast to the earlier Western Zhou, which is when the Zhou kings actually held power. Anyway, during the Spring and Autumn period, various Chinese states took turns dominating, including Qi, Song, Jin, Qin, and Chu. And to the north was an additional state, known as Wu. It is perhaps from Wu, as well as the ancient Korean kingdom of Gochoson, that the ancestors of the modern Japanese came. Originally, Japan was inhabited only by the indigenous Jomon peoples, but during the Chinese Spring and Autumn period, settlers from mainland Asia arrived, and it is from these settlers that most Japanese people today descend. Interestingly, it is also at this time that the first emperor of Japan, Jimmu, is thought to have lived. However, most historians see Jimmu as being strictly a legendary figure, not an actual emperor. It was during the Spring and Autumn period that two of the most important philosophers in Chinese history lived, Confucius and Lao Tzu. Roughly speaking, they were the contemporaries of the Buddha, of Mahavira, who is the founder of Jainism, and also of many of the Jewish prophets, as well as classical Greek philosophers such as Plato. In China, the Spring and Autumn period eventually evolved into the Warring States period. By this point, Jin had split into Zhao, Wei, and Han, and together with Qin, Chu, Qi, and Yan, there were now seven major states who were fighting for supremacy. It was during this period that Sun Tzu, or Sun Tzu, wrote his famous book, The Art of War. Eventually, one state was able to win out and unify all of China. This was Qin, which might be where the word China comes from. But before we look at Imperial China, let's now move to the other side of the chart, to the other major region in Asia where a lot of change was happening, India. You'll note that there are separate timelines for North India and South India. This is because what was happening in the northern part of the subcontinent was often quite different from what was happening in the southern part. The two areas also have notable differences in terms of language. Most South Indians today speak Dravidian languages, such as Telugu and Tamil, whereas most North Indians speak Indo-Aryan languages, such as Hindi and Punjabi. This distinction has its roots in the period just prior to 800 BCE, which is known as the Vedic period. And this is where things get controversial. During the 19th century, a theory developed called the Aryan invasion theory, which posited that Vedic culture was the result of fair-skinned invaders called Aryans conquering indigenous Indians and introducing quote-unquote advanced culture. These Aryans were also said to be the ancestors of Northern Europeans, which is why the British colonizers of India were so keen on the theory, and why the Nazis later picked up the word Aryan and used it to push their racist ideology. But the Aryan invasion theory has now been completely debunked. We now know that a quote-unquote advanced urban civilization existed in the Indus Valley way back when the pyramids in Egypt were still being built. But this doesn't mean that those who go to the opposite extreme are correct either. For example, it's quite common in Hindu nationalist circles for people to claim that Vedic culture goes back tens of thousands of years and that there was absolutely no influence from areas to the northwest. This is simply untrue. There are clear linguistic and genetic connections between Europeans and North Indians, and this is likely due to Indo-Aryan speakers slowly migrating into the area for at least 1,000 years prior to the start of this chart, around the same time that the Indus Valley civilization was declining, perhaps due to climate change. These newcomers likely intermixed with those already living in India to create the unique Vedic culture that existed in northern India in 800 BCE. With that out of the way, we can now talk about the history of India. By the late Vedic period, there were 16 small kingdoms or republics in North India known as the Mahajanapadas. One of these realms, the Kingdom of Magadha, eventually grew to become the dominant one. It was during this period that the Buddha lived. Then, around the same time as Alexander the Great, there arose a king in India named Chandragupta, who established the Mauryan Empire, which reached its peak under his grandson, Ashoka. The Mauryan Empire unified most of the Indian subcontinent for the first time, even bringing much of southern India under its influence. Perhaps most importantly, it was during the Mauryan period that the Brahmi script developed, which is the parent script for all the major writing systems in India today, as well as in much of Southeast Asia. But the Mauryan Empire was short-lived, lasting only a little more than 100 years. After this, the north divided into many smaller kingdoms, and in the south, a major power known as the Satavahana Empire dominated. It was around this time that Indian culture also started to spread to Southeast Asia, where several Indianized kingdoms started to pop up, and that a hybrid Indo-Greek culture emerged near what is today Pakistan. But at this point, let's go back to China, where it was experiencing its first golden age. As I mentioned earlier, China was initially unified by the Qin. At this point, Zhao Zheng, the King of Qin, became the first ever Chinese emperor, known as Qin Shi Huang. But the dynasty of Qin Shi Huang was extremely short-lived. After his death, the emperorship was taken over by a rebel leader named Liu Bang, later known as Gaozu. He established the Han Dynasty, which went on to rule Imperial China for the next 400 years, except for a small interlude in the 1st century CE. The Han Dynasty shares a name with the Han people, who today make up over 90% of the Chinese population and are the largest ethnic group in the entire world. The most famous Han emperor was Emperor Wu. It was during his reign that the Korean kingdom of Gochoson was defeated and that the Silk Road was established, linking East Asia to India for the first time, which meant that it was now also connected to the Middle East, Africa, and Europe. Over in North India, it was the Kushan Empire that eventually became the hub between West and East. It is thought that Kushan monks were likely the ones who brought Buddhism to China sometime during the late Han Dynasty. Around that same time, paper, as in the same kind of paper that we still use today, was invented in China by a man named Kailan. But as with all great empires, the Han Dynasty eventually came to an end, splitting into three kingdoms in the 200s CE. One of those three kingdoms, Wei, eventually conquered the other two, establishing the Jin Dynasty. But before the Jin Dynasty could really get rooted, the North was taken over by various so-called barbarian groups. Some of these were members of the Xiongnu Confederacy, a nomadic group that may also have been the ancestors of the Huns and Turks, who went westwards towards Europe instead. It was during the next several hundred years, during what could be called the Chinese Middle Ages, that most of the Han Chinese migrated south into the regions where they dominate today. It was also during this time that three major kingdoms, Goguryeo, Baekje, and Silla, came to dominate the Korean peninsula, and also that a unified kingdom started to emerge in Japan, centered at Yamato. Trade between China, Korea, and Japan was ongoing throughout this time, and it was sometime during this period that both Chinese writing and Buddhism made their way into Japan. Interestingly, it was during the Chinese Middle Ages, when China was experiencing a bit of a low point, that India experienced one of its major high points, with the emergence of the Gupta Empire. The Gupta Empire was the golden age of Hindu literature. This is when the famous epics the Mahabharata and the Ramayana were compiled into the versions that we know today. Eventually, China was once again united, this time by Yang Jian, better known as Emperor Wen of Sui. But just like how the unifying Qin Dynasty was quickly replaced by the Han Dynasty, the unifying Sui Dynasty was quickly replaced by the Tang Dynasty. And the Tang Dynasty, especially under the leadership of Emperor Taizong, ended up becoming China's second major golden age. It was also during the Tang Dynasty that Empress Wu Zetian, China's first and only Empress Regnant, ruled. During the approximately 300 years that the Tang Dynasty ruled China, Korea and Japan were also developing into stronger, more unified states. In Korea, one of the three kingdoms, Silla, ended up conquering the other two, and in Japan, they started to model their state on Tang China, making their monarch into an emperor who, in their minds, was the equivalent of the Tang Emperor. Elsewhere in Asia, several other major states formed as well, such as the Tibetan Empire in the Himalayan region and the Srivijaya Empire in what is today Indonesia and Malaysia. However, over in India, the Gupta Empire had faded away, and eventually the subcontinent became a battleground between three equally strong states: the Gurjara Pratiharas, the Palas, and the Rashtrakutas. Finally, I should point out that over in Central Asia, on the edges of the Middle East, the Turks who had settled there converted to Islam during this period, an event that would have huge consequences for the Middle East in the centuries ahead. Let's now take a look at what was happening across Asia in the year 1000, a century after the fall of the Tang Dynasty. First of all, in China, the Tang Dynasty had collapsed, and after a brief period of division called the Five Dynasties and Ten Kingdoms period, it was replaced by the Song Dynasty. During the Song Dynasty, gunpowder, movable type printing, and the compass were all invented. Together with paper, these are known as the Four Great Inventions. Meanwhile, in Korea, the kingdom of Goryeo ruled the peninsula, and Buddhism was experiencing a golden age there. In Japan, the power of the Japanese emperor had declined to a point where the emperor was now merely a figurehead. And in Southeast Asia, a new major power had risen, the Khmer Empire, famous for building the Angkor Wat complex. Finally, over in India, a major power emerged in the south known as the Chola Empire. Under the rule of its most famous king, Rajaraja I, the Cholas controlled most of the eastern Indian Ocean, including much of what is now Sri Lanka and Indonesia. Then, approximately 200 years later, around 1200 CE, a major turning point occurred throughout the entire continent due to the rise of the largest empire in all of Asian history, the Mongol Empire, which was established by Genghis Khan. The Mongols started by conquering Central Asia, but then conquered China as well, where they were known as the Yuan Dynasty. Their exploits reached as far as the island of Japan in the east and Java in the south, to the Middle East and Central Europe in the west. But despite controlling lands on almost all sides of the Indian subcontinent, they were never able to make serious conquests over the Muslim dynasty occupying much of the north, the Delhi Sultanate. Okay, let me finish the rest of this chart by going region by region, starting in the west. After Genghis Khan, the next greatest conqueror to come from the Asian steppes was probably Timur. His empire dominated most of Western Asia during the 1400s, but perhaps even more important, one of his descendants ended up conquering the Delhi Sultanate in the year 1526, establishing the Mughal Empire, which at its greatest extent controlled most of India. Under its most famous emperor, Akbar the Great, the Mughal Empire became the richest empire on earth, and his grandson would go on to build the famous Taj Mahal. But shortly after the Taj Mahal was built, things started to get more complicated on the Indian subcontinent. For one thing, several European colonial powers had arrived and were starting to establish trading posts along the coasts. And secondly, the Hindu Marathas were starting to achieve independence and were building an empire that would eventually eclipse the Mughals. The three-way power struggle between the Mughals, Marathas, and Europeans was eventually won by the Europeans, with the British establishing direct rule in India in 1858. This lasted until after World War II, when India received independence and split into the majority Hindu India and the majority Muslim Pakistan. Moving over to Southeast Asia, Srivijaya was eventually replaced by the Majapahit Empire, but by the start of the modern era, it was replaced by several Muslim sultanates, and then by various European powers. For example, in what is today Malaysia, the Malacca Sultanate was followed by Portuguese Malacca, then Dutch Malacca, then British Malaysia, before the area finally achieved independence post-World War II. In the Philippines, prior to 1500, the islands were divided into many small kingdoms, but soon after the arrival of Magellan, whose expedition was the first to circumnavigate the globe, the Philippines was taken over by the Spanish under the reign of Philip II, from whom the Philippines gets its name. The Spanish ruled there for 300 years before handing it over to the United States following the Spanish-American War. The Philippines was then an American colony for almost 50 years before getting its independence, like most parts of Asia, soon after World War II. We now come to China. The Mongol-led Yuan Dynasty was eventually defeated by the Ming Dynasty. They were the ones who built the Forbidden City in Beijing and built the parts of the Great Wall that are the ones still standing today. They were followed by the final imperial dynasty, the Qing Dynasty. The Qing emperors were actually from Manchuria to the north and therefore were not ethnically Chinese. They ruled China until the Xinhai Revolution, when China became a republic. Of course, soon after this, the man known as Chairman Mao took over, leading the Communist Revolution and making China into the communist state it is today. In Korea, the kingdom of Goryeo was followed by the kingdom of Joseon, whose most famous ruler was Sejong the Great, creator of the Korean writing system that is still used today. In the 1800s, China and Japan ended up fighting over Korea, with Korea eventually becoming part of the Empire of Japan until after World War II, when it split into the North Korea and South Korea that we are familiar with today. Finally, Japan. As I mentioned earlier, the Emperor of Japan evolved into a mostly figurehead position well over 1,000 years ago. Eventually, military dictators known as shoguns from various rival clans became the true rulers. There were three main shogunates in Japanese history: the Kamakura shogunate, the Ashikaga shogunate, and finally the Tokugawa shogunate. That final shogunate came to an end with the rise of Emperor Meiji, who took back power and built the Empire of Japan, which, as you probably know, was one of the Axis powers during World War II. Now, before I go, I should point out that this chart is actually labeled Asia-Pacific, and it includes a little about Oceania as well. I haven't mentioned it throughout because the peoples of Oceania have had very little contact with Asia until more recent times, but let me give you a quick recap of their history. By 800 BCE, which is where this chart starts, Polynesian peoples had reached the islands of Fiji, Samoa, and Tonga, and Australia and New Guinea were populated only by the indigenous hunter-gatherers there. By 800 CE, 1600 years later, Polynesians had reached Hawaii and Easter Island, as well as Tonga, and started to expand. In fact, there was a pretty large sea-based empire for several hundred years in the Pacific Ocean, which could be called the Tongan Empire. Around the same time, the famous Easter Island statues were built by the people there, and for the first time ever, humans reached New Zealand. That's right, prior to the arrival of the Maori around the year 1300, New Zealand was uninhabited. Several hundred years later, though, Europeans started to arrive, and of course, eventually, two of the largest states in Oceania, Australia and New Zealand, were eventually formed. Okay, so obviously that was a very quick summary. Asia is a huge continent and much more could have been said. But my goal was simply to give you an overview so that you could better understand the various time periods and how the various civilizations and empires relate to each other in time. In future videos, we'll be doing similar overviews of the other three charts, one for Africa and the Middle East, one for Europe, and one for the Americas. If you want to take a look right now, you can find a link to Matt's new book in the description and pinned comment. Thanks for watching.